That's why I'll say year by year one of the things that I love the thought. And the thought is this, that when God wanted to launch something brand new on our earth, and he knew he had something that was just absolutely filled with destiny and filled with purpose, and he desired to start the human race, what did he do? He took Adam and he took Eve, and neither one of them had a past. Because God, when he wants to launch something new and when he has something great in mind, he loves to use people who are not tied to their past, but who can see the future and see what's before them and accomplish greatly what he wants to do without being chained to the past. Now, that's why we always look at being able to be released from the old baggage of a year and be able to move beyond it as we get into each new year, because it's so vital that we find our identity not in the frustrations and the lowered expectations of the past, but instead that we find our identity in what God has marked out for us in the days ahead. God is never outdone by what he's done before. God has greater things for you than you can ever imagine. So in Isaiah 43, 18 and 19 is a scripture that I look at every single year. Get used to it. You'll hear it year by year. And it's not my main text this morning, but I do want to read it to give you what I think is one of the most powerful revelations you'll carry with you through life. And if you have heard this before and you've already applied it in your life, that's wonderful. But there are people that you will meet in the year 2009 who will need this revelation. They'll need this truth. You'll find yourself in a conversation and you will need to apply this. And God will touch you to be able to share this and change a life. Here it is, Isaiah 43, 18 through 19. I'll be reading it out of the New International Version. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. You may feel like you've gone through a year that you would describe more like a desert and a wasteland than any oasis. And that's understandable. 2008 was a difficult year in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways, it was wonderful. In a lot of ways, it was challenging. But as you go into 2009, you're not to be held to anything that could pull you back when God wants you to go forward. So when we look in Isaiah and the Bible says, forget the former things, that is not speaking to a mental exercise. That is not you trying your best to hit your head against the wall and say, forget that. I'm doing my best to forget that. Now I'm going to hit myself again to forget that. That's not what that means. Forget the former things. That literally is translated, do not relive. Write that down if you're taking notes. Forget right there actually is translated, do not relive. I'm going to give you other words that start with re so you'll remember them, because when you think and you're sharing this, you're going to remember. I know they were re words, and you won't be wrong with almost any re word you'll use here. Okay, do not relive, do not revisit, do not reenact, do not rehearse. When you, and there are other rewords too that you could probably use there, when you consider this, basically what it's saying is that you're not to simply try and win past debates. You're not to try and win past arguments. You're not to try and rehearse something until you get to a point where you've talked yourself so through it on your pillow at night that you feel now you've thought it through from every angle. The past is the past. Now it's time to be able to move on. The title of my message this morning is, Don't Be a Past Dweller. You'll miss the something new that is spoken of in Scripture when God says, behold, I do a new thing. And you don't want to miss what is new for you in the year 2009 because you're so busy grabbing a hold of what is the past. The revelation that speaks to us this morning is that you're not held to the lowest points in your life. You are not held to the lowest common denominator of what you look back on. Nothing that is the chains of the past can hold you when it comes to what God wants to do in the year 2009. Not one thing. Your identity needs to be linked to God. Your identity needs to be linked to what God has placed in you, because God is now putting a demand on what he's placed in you. He is tapping you and saying, I placed something in your DNA. There's a calling on your life, and I am right now tapping it. In the year 2009, I am tapping what I've placed in you. Watch, because it's greater than anything you have known thus far. That's the God that goes from glory to glory to glory. Your past, those things that are the lowest common denominator, do not identify you. Some of you have placed yourself in a position of identifying yourself, your life story, by your disappointments, by your struggles, by those things where you feel that you didn't measure up, or something that happened to you that you wish didn't. All of those low common denominators right now are under the blood. And when Jesus died on the cross, he died on the cross because he is a triumphant Savior. And he rose from the dead. And the power of the resurrection is upon you. And that's who you are. And that's your inheritance and your identity in Jesus. And so when you come before God in humility and in repentance, and you say, God, I can't do this myself. I need you. You're my heavenly Father, and I give you my life in the year 2009. I give you every memory. I give you everything that's the story of my past. I give you all of my DNA. I give you everything, every wish and every hope for the future. I give it all to you. And at that moment, the story that we're going to read through right now in Scripture speaks of the amazing relationship that you'll have with your Father this year. And how this year you're going to see the incredible love of your Heavenly Father and his ability to restore you and to heal you and to bring you into your true identity. In Psalm 103:12, the Bible says, as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. In fact, in the book of Micah, I like the way it's stated, because the Bible says that our transgressions are hurled in the depths of the sea. I mean, they're not just placed there. They're hurled there. And I like that thought. In Luke 15:11 through 24, we see a familiar story. And I want to read through it, just give a few insights from it, and then we'll have a time of taking communion together this morning. Let's look at the parable of the lost son. In the 11th verse of the 15th chapter, Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. By the way, this man, as you look at this man, is representative of your heavenly Father. That's the whole idea of this parable. So when we are studying this man and what he was like, we're understanding a little bit more about our heavenly Father and his heart towards us. And again, in the 11th verse, Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. 13th verse. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. Let's stop for a moment. I want you to see that this young man is doing things on his own terms. The time of the inheritance has not come, but he wants his inheritance now. He's stating that he wants it his way and he wants it in his timing.